Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, I would just like to say, Ms. Walker.
How are you going to do it, you know?
Order your stuff, please.
Well, good morning. What a beautiful day it is to be in the house of the Lord. Now, we're still continuing our topic of evangelism. Why are we still continuing it? Because it's important for several reasons. First of all, it's not just something that we do for fun, but God commands us in His Word to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Second of all, it needs to become our desire. And third of all, if we're really going to be effective in reaching people, we need to know where they're coming from. We know what we believe and why they believe it, but it helps us to know where they're coming from, that we may better reach them, that we may have a better understanding of where they're from, that we may show them the truth of God's Word. Because when it comes down to it, it doesn't matter what you or I say, it matters what God's Word says. It doesn't matter what they believe or even what we believe. What does God's Word say? We talked about witnessing to the Roman Catholic, and we looked at some of their beliefs. We saw that at the very beginning, their opening statement of salvation sounds very much like the Bible. But do you remember what changes or what makes their definition, what gives them a different perspective is the definition of some of their words. They take them not according to a biblical definition, but they put their definition on them, and because of that, it changes them from that salvation is through acceptance in Jesus Christ to being all stuck on works. We saw that they believe that water baptism completely does away with your sins. We know that's not true according to the Bible, because water baptism is nothing but an outward sign. It doesn't do anything for you spiritually other than the fact that you're obeying a command from God. It's obedience. But it's an outward sign. We looked at the Holy Eucharist. Do you remember what the Holy Eucharist is? It is communion. And what do the Catholics believe when it comes to communion? Exactly. It literally changes the bread into the body of Christ, and the blood literally turns into the wine literally turns into the blood of Christ. That big word is known as transubstantiation. And like I said, we've been looking at several beliefs in the Catholics, but there are other people that hold these beliefs as well. So we have an idea on how to deal with different people if necessary. We know that they adhere strictly and worship the saints, Mary.
They believe in
purgatory. And where do they get all the quote-unquote off-the-wall doctrines from? From the book of the Apocrypha, which is a series of 11 books. It was written during the intertestamental times between Malachi and the Gospels there, between the Old and New Testament. And the name Apocrypha literally doesn't mean end-time events like we might think automatically, but it means false writings. And even the Jews back then did not hold to them. We know that there have been many appearances of Mary throughout the world. If you get down to statistic-wise, to say that at least one of these events is false, statistic-wise, is not true. I mean, it's almost impossible. So, if there is a real event where someone sees an image of Mary or Mary speaks to them, is it really Mary?
No.
No. And if it's not Mary, then who or what is it? It is a demon. Because A, demons desire worship, and they'll come to us in whatever form we'll accept them in. It doesn't necessarily have to always be religious, but they will come to us in whatever form we will accept them in. They're sneaky and they're cunning. And that, if we're still on the topic of demons, real quick, we know that they'll do anything they can to get at us because A, they hate God and they wouldn't get back to him through us. And when it comes down to it, they're not out to play games. They're out to kill, steal, and destroy. That is their motive and that is their goal. We saw, and just wrapping up review, that the Catholics believe in two types of sins, moral sins and venial sins. Some sins will keep you out of heaven, but some will just give you a later sentence in purgatory. We know that does not hold up to the Bible because when we look at the Word of God, sin is sin. It doesn't matter. There is no classification. As human beings, and this is Catholic side, as human beings, we like to label sin, we like to put it in categories, well, this sin isn't as bad as that one. But it doesn't matter if it's a venial sin, moral sin, or in our mind's eye, this sin isn't as bad as that person's sin. Sin is sin to God. And it's all going to keep us from heaven. We don't need to confess to a human being. Because there's only one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And with that being said, we'll move on to, well, let's pause here for a moment. Any thoughts, any questions, any input at this point before we move on and start talking about the truth?
You know,
stand up and say that the devil has no power is a dangerous territory. I remember an account of Lester Summerall. He was a preacher, Pentecostal preacher in Indiana years and years and years ago. And he stood up one Sunday and made the statement that the devil has no power. Well, next Sunday he got up and apologized because the devil was attacking him that week. And yes, the devil does have power. But we are victorious over him, not because he is powerless, but because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world, because of the power of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, when we start talking about the Jews, we can find that there's been several Jewish movements in the 20th century in the United States or in the 1900s. Years and years ago, and I realize these are old stats, but there were approximately 6,483,900,000 Jews in the world. World's 13.2 million, in the world at that time, 13.2 million Jews lived in the United States, and I believe it was 2000. There are basically three major movements in the U.S., or there were in the U.S., Reform, Conservative, and Orthodox. I just want to take a step back that we normally see something similar to this with the Catholic Church to a degree. There's always going to be those separate sects. One's old, sticks to the old ways, some are maybe a little bit more reformed, and some are conservative. Some people also include a fourth movement, the Reconstruction Movement, although that movement is substantially similar, smaller than the other three. So when we're looking in the 1900s, there were three movements of Jews. The first one is the Orthodox Jew. When we think Orthodox, we go back to the main roots, how it was in the old days. They were mostly traditional, conservative, and strict. There are several groups that are contained within the Orthodox group itself. They are the ones that have been integrated into society and maintain observance of halakha, not Hanukkah, but halakha, which is the Jewish law, the chasdim, and they live separately and dress distinctly, commonly referred to in the media as the ultra-Orthodox. And then you have the Yeshivish Orthodox, who are neither Chassidic nor modern, so they fall somewhere in between. There's been estimated that there were 1,200 Orthodox synagogues in America back in 2000, with a total of approximately 1 million members. So that's a lot of Jews here in America. Then you fall into the conservative Jew. They're less conservative than the Orthodox Jew, but not liberal like the Reform. So they're the ones that stay in the middle. And when you look at conservative Judaism, it grew out of tension between Orthodox and Reform. So you had kind of a split going on, and they were the ones that went right down the middle. So this is Here We Stand. And it began basically when a Reform organization threw a dinner serving shrimp. Some more traditional rabbis were offended because shrimp is not a kosher food. It's not something that they are allowed to eat according to law. It's kind of like serving pork. And walked out, forming their own movement. And remember, when it comes to like pork, it's the old Levitic law that you're reading in your own Bible. Don't eat anything with a split hoof. Conservative Judaism generally accepts the binding nature of halakha, which is the law, but believes that the law should change and adapt. There are an estimated 800 conservative synagogues in America today with approximately 1.3 members. Then you have the Reform Judaism, which falls into the other side, the liberal side. And they do not believe that the Torah was written by God. When we look at the Jews, the Torah are the five books of Moses. We call it the Pentateuch. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Reformed Jews do not believe in observance of commandments as such, but they retain much of their values and ethics of Judaism along with some of the practices and the culture. Many non-observant nominal or agnostic Jews identify themselves as Reformed simply because Reform is the most liberal movement, but that is not really a fair reflection of the movement as a whole. There are about 800 Reformed synagogues in America with approximately 2 million members today. So when we look at this, there are some Jews that identify as Reformed, but they don't really have any belief system as far as when it comes to God or the old observances, what they're supposed to do. And we take a step back, we can see that in society today, even in the Christian world, because there are a lot of people that identify as Christian, but they're not Christian. Or maybe they'll go to a liberal church that maybe doesn't teach the full gospel. They're there, but they don't really believe it. Then you have Reconstructionist Judaism, which are modern and they're always changing. And according to Reconstruction Judaism, there's theoretically an outgrowth of conservative, but it does not neatly fit into traditional or liberal, observant, non-observant continuum that most people use to classify movements of Judaism. Reconstructionists believe that Judaism is an evolving religious civilization. So it's always changing, it's always happening. They do not believe in a personified deity that is active in history. They do not believe that God chose the Jewish people. From this, you might assume that Reconstructionist is to the left of Reform, yet Reconstructionists lay a much greater stress on Jewish observances than Reform Judaism. So they're way out there in left field, but they like to hold on to their traditions. Then you have the ultra-Orthodox movement. These are very strict in keeping the law of Moses and the Jewish religion and all of its past teaching and customs. It is a separatist group and with its own communities and avoids being involved with non-Jews as a whole. So that's a quick rundown of the movement, Jewish movements in the 19th century, or 1900s, I should say. So it gives us an idea of what's kind of out there. Yeah. Which really isn't that much of a surprise because, just like any other religion, it seems at least Christianity, you have your small sects, you have those that are really conservative, and then you have those that are way out there in left field, keeping nobody company. And that was an Abbott Costello joke. Because we all know who's on first. So when we get down to it, Judaism has three main books that they adhere to. They have what we might classify as the Bible, but when we look at the Bible according from the Jewish perspective, they don't believe in the 66 books that we hold to, because they do not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. So the New Testament is cut off for them, but they do believe in the Old Testament. To them, that is the Bible. Those are the Holy Scriptures. They also may be referred to as the Old Covenant. And as I've already said, they do not accept the New Testament because to the Jew, they do not accept Jesus Christ as the Messiah. That is one of the big differences between Christianity and Judaism. We believe that Jesus came in the flesh. He was the Son of God. They do not. When it comes to the Old Testament, many Jews don't believe in it as the Word of God. They accept it as the history of Israel, with part of it being fable and part of it being poetry. And then we get from the Holy Scriptures, they also believe in the Torah. Not Torah, but the Torah. And it consists of the five books of Moses, which are anybody know who what the five books of Moses are? The Pentateuch. Very beginning of the Bible. You got it, brother. They were just not in order. Maybe you're trying to put them chronologically, which is all right. But when we look at the Bible, books of the, I say that jokingly, the books of the Bible, if we look at them how we have them, they weren't arranged chronologically. So, but all five books are there. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That's the Torah. They believe that the book, that the Torah came from God through Moses. At least the Orthodox Jews believe that the Torah came from God through Moses. The Reformed Jews have varied beliefs in whether or not they are truly from God, whether or not they might be. But the Orthodox Jews, the Torah is the Word of God. So you have the Bible, you have the Torah, and then you have the Talmud. When it comes to Judaism, this is an extremely important book. It is made up of two sections, the Mishnah and the Gemara. Now, if we start breaking it down, what are these two, the Mishnah and the Gemara? The Mishnah, the Jewish people believe that when God gave Moses the written law on Mount Sinai, God also gave Moses an oral law. This was passed down from generation to generation by word of mouth, and it was put into writing around 280. These writings are called the Mishnah. The Mishnah includes a list of 39 laws and categories for Jews to keep in order to be justified. When you look at the Gemara is this. The rabbis made commentaries on the Mishnah. So the Gemara are the rabbis' words interpreting the Mishnah. And that is called the Gemara. The Mishnah and the Gemara together make up the Talmud. So these two together make up the Talmud. Kind of like when we look at the Old Testament and the New Testament in our Bible, that makes up the Bible. It's not the Old Testament, it's not just the New Testament, but it makes one book called the Bible. They have the Gemara and the Mishnah together form the Talmud. And it is on equal authority with the Holy Scriptures. Does this apply to us as Christians, especially when it comes to reading the Word of God? It does in a huge way. Because if we return to the book of Matthew chapter 5, and if someone would please read verse 38 and 39. Matthew 5, verses 38 and 39. Jesus start off saying? Ye have heard it said. What's he referring to? He's referring to the Talmud. He's referring to the fact that this is what the rabbis told you. This is what was in the commentary, because the Jews held the Talmud on equal authority as the Word of God. And this was radical because he goes, you have heard it said. So he places himself in verse 39 on the same equal footing as the rabbis. But I say unto you, this was completely unheard of. He was placing his own word as the same word as the rabbis of the past, who had many credentials, and as the Word of God itself. So just pointing that out, that was kind of a side note. So the Gemara and the Talmud were held in high regard, even though it was a quote-unquote written law. It really wasn't Word of God. It was oral tradition passed down. And it had rabbi's notes, man's words, combined within it, interpreting it. Now, if we're not careful in our own life, we can be just as guilty as the Jews when it comes to our version of the Talmud. What do I mean by that? Several of us have study Bibles within the sanctuary. If we take the notes and the side notes on equal footing as the actual Word of God, we're no different than them. Those are just man's words. It is not the Word of God. It's just man's thoughts and man's words on the Word of God. So you have the Torah, which are the five books of the Bible, the Holy Scriptures, which is the Old Testament, and they hold to the Talmud, which is the oral laws passed down through Moses, which is what they believe, with the rabbi's notes included in it. And then finally, you have the Siddur, the Jewish prayer book. The Siddur is used in Jewish worship services. This book contains the order of worship for the holy days and holiday services. These books come in Hebrew and English. Scripture is quoted in the Siddur as well as the traditions handed down by the rabbis. 13 principles of faith are also found in the book. These principles were written by a 12th century Jewish philosopher named Moses Maimonides, and these principles are good and should be used in witnessing, ordinances to go with. So, we need to know how to present the gospel message to the Jew. We know where he's coming from. We've been exposed to Jewish tradition, to Jewish practices, probably for years and years and years, because we've been going to church for how long. When we look at the Bible itself, it's a Jewish book. It really is. What brings it out sometimes is studying Jewish tradition, the Lord practices. Out of 40 authors in the Bible, only one of them was a Gentile. So it's mainly a Jewish book. So how can we present the gospel message to the Jew? We need to show them that Jesus was the Son of God come in the flesh. One of the first ways that we can start showing the Jew that God is Trinity is by proving to them that there is a plural form used to represent God. If someone would please read or quote Genesis 1 and verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. What is the very first commandment? Or you can read Exodus 20, verse 3. Absolutely, brother. I'm just not using that one here, brother, because I don't have it in my notes and I know what the Hebrew word is that I'm looking for here. But the very first commandment, Thou shalt have no other gods before me. If we get down to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. If you take the Hebrew word for God in Genesis 1 and verse 1, which is Elohim, Genesis 2, the Spirit of God, once again, the Hebrew word used is Elohim. The first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Gods is actually translated from the Hebrew word Elohim. When we look at that word Elohim, it is a singular word, but it has a plural meaning. So when it gets down to it, one God with multiple personalities, as we refer to it as. If we get down to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26, we get more evidence that God is not just one person in the Godhead. It's not just him. What does Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26 read? Genesis 1:26. Someone else find Genesis 3:22.
God said, let us make man our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
So God said, let me make man in my image. No, he said, let us, when we imply, use that word us, it's not just me, myself, and I, but it's me and somebody else. And then he said, let us make man in not my image, but our image. Once again, implying more than one. So there's one God with multiple persons. What does Genesis chapter 3 and verse 22 say?
The Lord God said, behold, man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. And now, must he perform the same, and they also appear to be and he will live forever.
So God said, behold, man has become as me. No, he said, man has become as us. If we would go down to the account of the Tower of Babel, God said, let us go down there and there and confound their language. If we go to the book of, the book of Isaiah, God said, whom shall I send and who will go for us? So when we look at God, there's one God, but there's multiple personalities. And when we're presenting the gospel message to the Jew, we need to show him that there isn't just God, one God, but I take that back. There's one God, but there's multiple facets to him. There's different personalities. It's not just one, but there's several in that one. And when we can use that word Elohim, because it's a singular word, it's one word, but it has multiple meanings. We find other evidence that there's more than one persona in the Godhead. Once again, one God, but there's different personalities or different persons. In Psalm 51 and verse 11, someone please find Psalm 51 and verse 11. Not thy Holy Spirit from me. If you have taken notice so far, we haven't moved from the Old Testament. Why haven't we moved from the Old Testament? The Jews don't believe in the New Testament. So we are showing them from their holy scriptures who God is. In Psalm 139 and verse 7, David wrote, whither shall I go from thy spirit? The Old Testament teaches that the Spirit of God is one as well as distinct from God. He has different functions, he has different workings, he has a totally different administration. What does Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 4 state?